Silicon Mountain is actually a community of innovation entrepreneurs in Boya. Okay, so it's Silicon Mountain, named after Mount Cameroon.
A research was done, I think, in 2016, and it was found that more than 40 technology-based startups are found in the Southwest region. So we thought to ourselves, we can liken it to the Silicon Valley, but now we have a mountain right here, and so the name Silicon Mountain.
A lot of people don't know what Silicon Mountain is all about. But to me, Zo Bruno, Silicon Mountain is a tech ecosystem. It is a place or an environment created by the tech guys around the Fako Mountain. This includes Boya, Limbe, right, even right up to Kumba, Moyuka.
If Silicon Mountain is organized as an association, they can arguably penetrate the government by way of accessing loans to Silicon Mountain as a community and not maybe Churchill or Bruno or Kamga in the Silicon Mountain community. But what they usually told me is that if they form an association, Silicon Mountain is going to die. So they prefer to work it that way, individual but in a particular community.
It is at the foot of this 4,000 meters height of a mystery that a community like none other is sprouting. Call it the Silicon Mountain community, or just a band of tech heads with a sharp penchant for innovation. At the foot of Mount Cameroon, it seems every little problem has a technological approach to its solution. This is Mpara Faith. She did some internships with schools and discovered a problem with the compiling of marks.
During internship, we worked with the school, St. Anthony's Guild Diligent Foundation, Kumba, and we saw how difficult it was for them to manage records.
So Mpara Faith came up with an idea that uses codes to create a software solution.
I saw that it would be important to build a computer-based system to manage this. We find that it's difficult when humans have to handle some computations and records keeping all the time. So that was our motivation for developing a system for school. But after school, we realized that even businesses, like the retail business, has this challenge as well. Then we embarked on developing a system as well for retail shops and for pharmacies. In most schools, if you go to your school to get a transcript, you spend a day or 2 days to get a transcript. One of the reasons is that most records are kept in big books called master sheets, and the accountant, the school secretary or school clerk, needs to get all of these books and compile the results. But with Scholar, all of the marks that teachers fill get directly into the system, and if you need a transcript, the transcript is out with one click. So that happens in like less than a minute. So it makes it easier for schools to have their records. Another way that Scholar works is to just facilitate input of information. For example, with the master sheet system, one teacher takes a master sheet, he fills marks in it, whatever time it takes. But with Scholar, multiple teachers fill marks at the same time. The system automatically computes their averages and ranks the students. That way, the teachers don't have to worry about computations, we don't have to worry about accuracy, and then less time is spent trying to get these records. That is how Scholar works.
Record keeping is a very important aspect of an education system's information cycle. It has a fundamental role in building a culture of accountability because it provides proof. This head teacher runs a school keeping traces of attendance in class. Performance in classwork and other school activities is a day-to-day concern for him and his staff members.
Record keeping, especially say in an institution like this, a school, record keeping is very, very important. because it helps you to get the day-to-day running of the activities within the school. And that's the only way that we can prepare ourselves, know how the school is running with the children that we take care of and the teachers that comes to school. First, I just go straight to the school register. The school register that we put down the names of the children inside. It helps us to know the presence and the absence of kids when they come to school, say in the morning, and when they are leaving in the afternoon. It helps us every day. Even security-wise, a parent can be at home and send the child to school. It is through the register that we may know that the child actually came to school or did not reach school. So if we don't keep those records, we may have some loopholes, especially with the children that we take care of. And still within the school, you know, in classrooms with the teachers, they have their own records where they take down the scheme of works, where they prepare their lessons. All those things, it helps them now to see how they can run their daily activities within the classroom. Each class has a register from classes 1 up to class 6. Even right down the nursery, they have their registers where when they come in the morning, they read the names of the children present in school. And in the afternoon, they reread the names of the children, whether they were in school throughout the day. So it helps. So from level class 1 up to class 6, they have registers. So in a school, we have 6 registers that carry on the registration of the children. The length of time that we keep registers within a school, at least if a register can stay within the school, each year they come in with new registers. And within 10 years, you may know the number of registers that we have in our keeping in a school. So, but when it gets up to that 10 years, all those ones that have gone up to 10 years within the school, we discard of them because the place will be all jam full with registers. And that's why we know that it must have expired. And many things, or those, their names that we registered within, or whatever we registered within the register for that period of time, must have been outdated. So we just discard of them.
Reason why, he says, ideas like that of Mpara Faith can change the way records are kept and managed in schools.
Even facilitates to keep records for life digitally. Well, we keep it now for life. You see that at any moment, even as I said before, concerning say 10 years to check something and discard of a record, with a digital system, we can keep it at any moment, whether somebody goes to where and come back at what time, you just go back to the, let's say the machines, put them on, and then you scroll back 10 years. You see all what happened some 10 years back. It helps. So the digital system is, I take it the most important and the best to manage documents, to manage records within an institution. The manual records that we used to keep, or we keep, because we still manage with the manual records, keeping them for too long, natural disasters like water, insects, rats, we have them all over. And when they destroy them, we'll never get them again, no matter how you can keep them. Except we say insecticides to help kill them, but you'll never finish rats to take care of your documents. They'll continue to grow up. And so that is why I think the digital system of keeping records should be the best.
Faith hopes that schools in Cameroon and beyond will come for her software, but she knows that there are hurdles to be expected.
Major challenge that people have reported working with our software is speed, and this is notable because for the most part IT has not gained ground in many institutions, even the educational institutions. We did a research in 2015 with about 90 schools, and only 70 of these schools even work with computers at all, management software. So it makes it difficult for them to understand specifications that software needs to use. So if you need to use a software, this is the kind of computer you need to have, because this is, and the number of records that are in it, it takes time to understand that, because for the most part they know Microsoft Word and they don't know about how these other systems that handle a lot of records and facilitate work goes. So speed has been an issue.
2005 figures from the National Statistics Office indicate that Boya has a population of over 2,000 people, growing at an average annual rate of 5%. It is considered one of the fastest growing towns in Cameroon today, with a mix of people from rural and urban settings. At the Boya Council, Figures show that 7,000 people migrate into the municipality each year for all kinds of reasons, between going to school and making money. Like in most cities, finding a house is a constant concern. After watching friends and relatives comb the city in a sweaty search for a good place to stay, Fungo Martin came up with a solution that is just a click away.
Every year, workers are transferred from one place to another by either the government or the private sector, and that actually causes people to be displaced from one place to another. Also in universities and higher institutes, they take in more than 1,000 or 10,000 students every year. So with that, it causes a mass movement of students from one town to another, even from one region to another, with the example of University of Boya. So with that movement, it causes people to relocate. And relocation is something that is very, very strategic, because if you don't have a good place to stay, you might not really work efficiently. We go around and we collect vacancy snapshots to give information about those houses and how you can get to them. So when we put it up on our platform, digitalrenter.com, people can actually go there, view the list of vacant houses, and then select the ones that they want, and then contact us. Since we presume that some people don't know the town, we provide tour guides to take them around and show them the houses, and then they can get to meet the landlords, the caretaker, or the property managers to discuss about the terms and agreement, and then they further pay and then move in.
Urban population could be put at 57% of total population, while the rate of urbanization is estimated at greater than 5% each year. In anticipation, Martin is reflecting on how to make his idea more robust and efficient for the growing population.
So far for the 7 months, we've had quite a number of requests here in Boya, because we are currently running our project now only in Boya, though we have a few spotted listings out. But for the past 6 to 7 months, we've had more than 100 to 200 contacts that people have contacted us on our platform, and we've had over 200 calls that have come in. More than 80% of those people have had their house, or have had a chance to get their house on the first day of outing. So we try to make the information valid, consistent, and ready at every time. Yeah. So we have a good success rate. I would like to provide a faster way where landlords can get to advertise their properties easily, because now the process is really tedious going around collecting those vacancies. So I think with more marketing and with more awareness of technological platforms such as Digital Renter, people can easily get to us, and then makes the work easier for us. And also we're looking at maybe getting base stations, getting more people into the field, so that, because what we're actually selling is a service plus data, because without data the system is not actually anything, so we need data.
You could call Zuoix Bruno the Silicon Mountain hacker, or just the Golden Lion. The virtual world holds little secrets for his fingers. He is the brain behind Zoom, an application that recently won him state recognition in the form of a Golden Lion and a cash prize.
Winning the Golden Lion was a milestone, I would say, because we did not expect to win. We had more than 500 people presenting wonderful innovation at the JESIC. But fortunately for us, we were thrilled that we won the Golden Lion. And right now, I can say it's a boost for us. The government has given us a very good boost, a very good tap on the back, that we should keep doing this. And as you can see for yourself, we are not stopping. We are using the money that we got to make this system better. We have even started to employ many people.
The application, he says, protects cars, homes, just anything with a door, from trespassers and thieves.
The Zoom application is actually one of such services that allows the users and the average population to secure their cars and vehicles using SMS, which is cheap, reliable, practical, and I can say for our own situation, very easy for our parents. to understand and use. I started this application. I wanted it to be like any other service out there in the market, to use the internet. But in late 2016, when the internet was disconnected, I have some friends who lost their vehicles. And so I decided to use an SMS-based system after trying to use radio frequencies. It was not easy at the time. It was very difficult. And I can say so far we are more than 90% gone in the total concept of it. We've designed and perfected most of the functions. And we're now looking at making more functions that would make the system more unique and more useful for the African people. The service is able to locate your car, to use geofencing to lock the car's location. So you might not want the car to go out of Limbe or Douala, for example. You can do that. You can also immobilize the engine if the car is stolen. You can call the car as a regular telephone so as to reduce the accident rates of people picking up phones. You can also eavesdrop on the car if it is being stolen. You can listen to what the thieves are saying inside. And you can also do a GPS location on the car using SMS. And right now, as we speak, you are able to know where the car is without even sending out an SMS, because the car now can send an SMS by itself to you at every given level or interval of time. So you can say every minute you want to know where the car is, or tell me where you are when you stop or when you start. The car is able to do that now.
Bruno, with his startup Zuoix, provides security solutions and applications to businesses, corporations and governments based on SMS. Absolutely no need to use internet if the user does not want to or cannot.
It's okay. What I'm going to do now is just call, and I'm just going to put this on loud. So I'm not even signaling them if it's okay, but let's see. Okay. So that's ringing. So you ring twice and then the car will pick up without letting them know. So I can get what they're saying. He's saying that anywhere in the world is going to work. I don't know if it's just sending a simple command saying location. Mm-hmm. And then after you write location, you put in your password, because this password is required for each command you send out. So we're going to send this command out to the car. And what the car is going to do that is that it's going to reply with a GPS coordinate. Okay. All you need to do is tap on that GPS coordinate and you open it with an offline map that we are developing. We are not the exact creators of this offline map, but we are actually making it to be better for the Cameroonian and African situation.
When minds start bubbling for solutions to everyday problems, one thing that quickly goes into short supply is space. The right ecosystem for these tender minds to meet, reflect, research, and keep track of one another's progress. That is where startups like Jungle Hub come in. Here is its founder, Mokate Ashu, addressing the US Congress in 2016.
Resilience and determination to overcome these barriers against all odds. And then the hope that I could make the difference by thinking and acting and equally being different revealed the leader in me.
Mokate Ashu describes himself as a miner, one who has staked his life on a new form of education, that of discovering and refining new mines that will change the continent.
The Hub is like a community for those entrepreneurs. So we bring them together here so they can interact with one another and be able to share their strengths. Okay, and besides that, we also provide a lot of trainings that help build their capacities. And then we connect them to different resources that could also help them establish their ventures and grow their ventures. So
at Jungle Hub, youths like Tani Jude, who is a master's student, come to meet other much younger minds to hone their talents in tech innovation.
Identify local problems and try to solve them using ICT. That's basically the internet, internet technologies. We have currently a set of products. We are trying to link businesses and small businesses, just like carpenters, plumbers, with their clients, their customers. So we are using ICT via messenger bots, actually, which we are developing, and a mobile application. One of the challenges we face is our clients, the like carpenters and plumbers, don't actually have smartphones. So one of the first solutions we were providing was through Android applications, but they did not have. So we had to go back and rethink the process of what we were doing. So we had to default to normal, act like a gateway, like middleman, get them registered, then now use online platforms, get those who are looking for their services and use normal mobile phone call and linking. For the people we work with, now most of them are students. Yeah, because Silicon Mountain is a young community. So when all of these community stuff entered Silicon Mountain, it was at the level where most of the pioneers were students. So I can see if they are workers now, they might have like 3 years of experience. So when we come to give back to the community, we are giving back with another majority of persons who are actually students. We can see from the age of 18, 17, 18, 24. Facebook Developer Circle program is a program by Facebook to actually create a developers community, a community where people that create solutions can come together, share, learn, and create solutions for their local communities. So I'm like pioneering that community in Boya, and it's the only community in Cameroon for now. And we are just one of the many of such communities in Silicon Mountain, because there's Google Developers Group too, there is a Docker community, Wikimedia community, and it's been one of the things that all of us as community leads, we have been trying to empower our communities using these different international bodies and organizations. And I really want to appreciate the organizations for what they have been trying to do by empowering us too, just like Facebook has been doing. Okay, as developer circles lead, we receive, we organize events, and Facebook sponsors these events. So Facebook provides budget for us to organize events to train and empower our local community. Applications have a little problem. Many people don't know about it. We develop applications, and to penetrate the market is also a very tough challenge. Sometimes, because the market is accustomed to using foreign applications, foreign products, so our main one other challenge is actually getting into the market, one of the problems. And if we are able to have activities or events that we can train the local community to know about what we are doing in Silicon Mountain in a much wider scale, and I think it will be very beneficial for us.
Apart from providing a meeting place for youths seeking technological awareness, Ashu, through his Jungle Hub, also provides virtual solutions to innovations that are not technology-based. For people like Ngum Daris, whose activity is a step away from the clicking sounds of technology, Jungle Hub is like a stitch in time.
Jungle Hub is actually like a meeting area where you have people in different domains. We meet here because if I want tech solutions, I want to brand my products, there are people here who can help me with that. So there's a lot of organizations. I know about Straw Academy that actually comes here, use internet time and space for them to be able to promote their products, and they deal with mindsets, just exactly the same thing that I do. I run the My 16 project, and I've been inspiring entrepreneurship in this country for some time. Then I thought, if we harness all our efforts and partnering with the organizations that constitute and make up Silicon Mountain, and we focus in one community and see transformation in that community, then we can now replicate what we did in that community to other communities. So we are headed for the nations, but we are looking at focusing in Maya 16, Bolifamba. And you ask the question, why Maya 16? Maya 16 is a community that is characterized by every social ill that you can think of. And we are thinking, if we can focus our energy there and transform it, then we can transform this nation. Now we're focusing especially on single mothers, and we're doing one project, which is the Papilio. We're producing reusable pads, and we have girls from Maya 16 that we are training to produce this for to improve the health of women, and also to help and empower these girls economically so that they better their lives, and then also provide a solution to our community. Most of the pads that we use, which are produced, disposable ones, are not that healthy. And so we are encouraging people to use these pads, which can be reused.
From money transfer, urban transport, to healthcare, technology in this part of town has seeped into the heart of almost every problem, notwithstanding problems of electricity and internet access.
The main challenge has been that of access to the kind of resources we need. One of the resources is internet. We have very slow speed internet. Right now, there's a group behind there that's working, and the big challenge is they don't have the kind of internet they actually need to carry out their work. And secondly, other technological infrastructures like hosting capacities. We don't have a big server that can permit startups actually really do their work effectively. We should have had a mini server here that should have really spurred our work, you know. And at some point you also lack the human resource, because you cannot afford to pay the qualified staff that can actually help these young startups grow.
You have this seizure for hours, and lots of work cannot go on that way. For the most part, like you find it difficult to like even understand what Silicon Mountain could be about. Majority of the society also tries to understand what an IT business can be. So while we struggle to serve them, we equally get projects online. But with the seizure, we cannot satisfy the clients online. And guess what? If Cameroon cannot meet their needs, they have India, they have China, they have Canada, they have people all over the world. It just says we are not reliable and we lose a lot of work. And internet speed as well is one which is just incapacitating, I would say. It is such a serious problem. We don't have the internet speed that we need to do the work that we have to do efficiently. It makes us not to be competitive in the market.
Currently in Silicon Mountain, we face some challenges, but I will say these challenges are at the level of the various startups. As a group, Silicon Mountain is thriving very well, but individual startups have problems. And I think that we have already identified most of these challenges and we are working towards them. For example, most of the startups now want to do what we call complementation. That means if I develop a service like this, someone else develop another service that complements what Zoom is doing. We already have these services coming up on Silicon Mountain, and I can say Silicon Mountain can only grow higher and higher from this level.
Sometimes you have a serious call that you have to make, maybe an online Skype conference call, and two things might disturb you: power and internet. So the power is actually something that, okay, we could say we use generators, but we are not so fond of generators here. But in the other part, there's the internet that really fluctuates sometimes, and it gets so slow that we don't really know how it happens. Even on the curb that was on the internet for a number of months, it actually had a terrible influence, a negative influence on our businesses. That's the first point. And then on the second point, I could take it down to policies. Some research that I did, I noticed there is no name, no term like a startup in Cameroon based on law, in the law. And with that, a startup is more of a project under research that we're still looking at, seeing a model that should work. So if we go, if the government can put some policies that favor startups. Policies could be such as the number of years that a startup can run without paying taxes, so that the startup can get to the point where it discovers the model that actually works and can generate income, thereby helping the startup to stand and sustain itself financially. That is the first point. And then the second point is, if the government can also help maybe ensure that some of these contracts that they are awarding to some international companies, maybe part of it could be awarded to small startups to also encourage them raise funds in order to foot the bills and other things. Apart from those four that I've listed, if any other one comes up, maybe I'll say.
Yet, Bruno says he would never have won the Golden Lion or any other recognition of that magnitude if he had not had help from unsuspecting sources. This is the National Employment Fund office in the Southwest region. This office welcomes, listens, advises, directs and accompanies job seekers in the search of salaried or independent employment. It is a state instrument that is free of charge and helps job seekers to acquire the skills sought in the labor market through trainings, links with enterprises and the financing and follow-up of self-employment and other micro-projects. The regional representative, Mr. Zinga Yusei, says he heard of Bruno and his project and decided to fish him out and support him.
I saw Zuo Bruno on TV after one of his reportage at CRTV, and I was a bit surprised by the fact that a young man like Zuo Bruno is based on Limbe, and from what I saw, I do all my best, I send my people on the field to find where Zuo Bruno is based on Limbe. Zuo Bruno comes in our office, and from the explanation he gives me, I saw that the project was, the idea was a wonderful idea, and I emphasize, I called my head office, I told them that we have an opportunity to help a young man with a great idea in a simple and wonderful project. What we did with Zuo Bruno is what we do for all the youth who come with an idea of project or with a project. We give him advice, we lay out his project, and with different council, we try to put in place the configuration of the project based on his own needs. We give him a loan of around 8 million according to his project. I think it was not easy at the beginning, knowing that concerning our procedure, the amount we generally give for this type of project are not going above 5 million. But for that case, we specially go out of our procedure because of the type of the project, because of the idea. So after his the authorization getting from the head office, after the credit committee, we give to Zuo Bruno training on how to manage small enterprise. And from that training, I think he have now a certain number of skills who can really permit him to correctly handle his business. I have to emphasize on one point. We realize that Zuo Bruno is really an entrepreneur. By the way he insists, by the way he follows the counsel, the advice our counselors gives to him, he had never stopped coming, doing the follow-up of his project, and it's one of the points who lacks to our young people who want to be self-employed. They have to be endurant, they have to be perseverant in what they are doing.
As he explains, his office does much more than just supporting tech startups. In the Southwest region, as in all of its offices across the country, the National Employment Fund also runs a project known as Support Program for the Creation of Jobs in Rural Areas. The program trains youths in villages to develop technical skills in the production and sale of their farm produce.
We trust the young people. The only important point is that the young people should be confident in what they are doing. The government is there. The government is giving help to those young people. Now, in front, the young people should merit that confidence put on them. They should trust on the National Employment Fund. We have at least 16 branches in the 10 region of the country. The only thing they have to do, they have to contact one of our branches with their idea of a project, or with a project, we are there to help them. According to our procedure, we are going to help them. The only main problem we have is our lack of means. We don't have enough means so that we can help so many young people as we want. We don't only give loans to those who want to be self-employed. We also have a certain number, let's say, a very large range of program concerning the youth people, starting from those who are looking for a job, for those who are looking for training, and you also see for those who are looking for a loan to be self-employed. Another important issue is that we are not only in towns, we also help people even in the rural area. We have so many programs we are developing in the rural area. Let's say we go in one village, we see what people have as usual activity, and we learn them how to modernize their activity, and then we can also give them a small loan. One of the last examples we had is the one we did in Mok, who is one of the biggest area in the production of Irish potatoes, where we have around 150 farmers there, and their production has really increased for more than 70% in terms of quality and in terms of production.
If you hang around Bruno or the Silicon Valley long enough, you will meet journalists like Solomon Agbarem.
I got to start doing some work with Zuoix Bruno by trying to investigate what he is doing and how practical it is. And I realized that this is interesting and we can also develop it. And we can only develop it if the public accept what is happening. And there is need for somebody to show the public that this is real, this is tangible, and this is workable. So I got to follow him and then get to know what he's working on. And through him, he got to also link me with other members of the Silicon Valley, Silicon Mountain, and this far, they have been doing quite a lot. For the time being, I've been able to cover their activities as a journalist from this perspective. Zuoix Bruno is working on a mobile app that has got to do with tracking your car, that has got to do with immobilizing your car as far as security is concerned. So Zuoix is very concerned with that. I'm able to do some work with him. If you talk about Achiri works with the traveler app that helps to prevent accidents. Or just in case there is an accident, there is an app that sends the information back to different systems and we can respond within a very short space of time. Churchill is also into what he calls it the job search engine, like the Njoku. Njoku in Bakuri represents a traditional dance, a traditional masquerade. So he decided to come with that traditional touch, and I was very interested to find out why did he choose that. And he says when the elephant comes out, it demonstrates a lot. And so in his own application, he tries to bring out the jobs that are available not only in Cameroon but across Africa. And so you can actually fit in that you want to go to Nigeria, you want to go to Benin to look for a job. His job search engine in Cameroon can actually identify that. And there's one thing I discovered with him. I tried to investigate him that how do you know that what is posted is fake? He told me that there are applications to also cross-check that, which he cannot disclose to me because that is his own icing of his cake, as he puts it. But I think that they are doing a lot to showcase this. Of course, I had the opportunity to also talk to Kamga. Kamga is also developing, he works with Google, and he does a lot in developing other incubation centers.
Curiosity first brought him to the community, and the resulting success stories of the youths involved kept him stuck.
They just need to follow their activities. You cannot appreciate from a distance, because I couldn't do that from a distance. I had to go in depth to find out who are these and how they are working. The public can best appreciate what they do when they organize their conferences. It's usually open for the public to also attend, like they have what they call the ICECON, organized each year. The public can always listen to the announcement and participate in this event and get to understand what they do. And from the public understanding them, they too have to create a platform for them to be understood by the public.
It is a story with many beautiful pages. Young people sprouting with tech solutions to everyday problems and beating the challenges as they march on. But they say this self-styled experience comes with its shares of thorns.
It's one of our teachers who said even the teeth and the tongue that have been together since they were born occasionally pleases the teeth to just bite the tongue. And you can imagine what it is like for several adults doing many different things, diverse visions, to come together and see how they can work. When these businesses began, we did not sit together and have a meeting. They just came a point and we said, wow, there are this number of people who are doing many different things. Let us get together and see how we can leverage on this. And that is something which I see as remarkable in the Silicon Mountain. So the youth who are in Silicon Mountain, one of the things that they enjoy is access to these businesses. For example, back in school, it was really challenging for me to get an internship. But here it is easier with these many startups to get an internship and to just do work. And it is easy to communicate like with the founders of the business and get an idea of how they think and just really understand in depth what the challenges are. If I had to understand that about the company in Douala, it would take me a while. The other things which youth get to work with, because, well, I wouldn't isolate the owners of the businesses because for the most part they are youth, is collaboration. For instance, the retail system which we build and work with and other systems we build in collaboration with other startup businesses. So those are some of the things that we enjoy being part of this community. At the moment, it is not really clear or obvious what policies say about startups. Startups are very much like research centers in the sense that there are businesses that are being grown and for the most part you're trying to check out will this work or will this not work, and especially for technology in Africa. So if there are some conscious policies drawn to address startups as startups, not as established businesses, I think that it would really help us to grow. For instance, with respect to taxation, yeah, I think it would be helpful.
What makes me proud is the people in it. Yeah. My opinion, because Silicon Mountain is an inclusive community, not headed by any person. It's a community of everybody. So I think the people is what actually makes us strong. We believe in hard work. Yeah, we believe in hard work. And we don't really, we're trying to focus ourselves on entrepreneurship. That is what I could say. Not actually only waiting for the government to employ us, but also looking for a way to employ ourselves and also provide employment for other young Cameroonians around. Because if we can actually provide employment, we're going to reduce things like juvenile delinquency, early pregnancy, theft, and other things.
However, it is with a heart full of hope that each of these minds open up to technology every other day.
It's actually a very disruptive community. Sometimes it's very challenging to understand. Everybody's always asking us, but who is like yours? They're looking at a structure in Silicon Mountain, and it's difficult to get a clear outline of a structure in Silicon Mountain. But that's really intentional. It's so because we're a disruptive community. We don't want political leadership to hinder progress, to hinder innovation. So we make sure that we are actually agile. Okay, so we are more of an agile community, allowing everybody who comes into their community to have the opportunity to get to the top. We meet up, there are like 5 hubs that I can personally identify, but there are also several startups. There are also some few companies that are already established. So we meet up very often to exchange ideas, to just in order to encourage one another to grow as an innovation entrepreneur. I've been very proud. Sometimes my head is always very up because of things that come out of here. One of the things is Silicon Mountain, one of the products here is Njoku. Njoku is actually the biggest job search engine. But it's not just only about Njoku, it's about the Afrovision itself, the Afrovision company where Churchill Mambe is the CEO. Okay, it's made a lot of waves as far as technology is concerned in Africa. We also know that the fastest transfer application called FIM currently in the world was developed here. UK was developed here, and those are some of the products. We hear of AgroHub. AgroHub is actually a digital agricultural hub, okay, that provides farmers, buyers, investors, you know, it brings them together in a hub so that they could, yeah, so it opens access to markets for farmers. You can imagine that a vegetable farmer who produces his food, his vegetable, is not able to sell and the vegetable gets bad. But with AgroHub, that technological platform, they are able to access markets through that hub. So a lot of technological solutions are out here at Silicon Mountain. But also the fact, the way we are organized, it's more of a natural community, right? It's rare to find people of same passion just come together and work together. Every year for the past 3 years, we've been able to achieve the Silicon Mountain Conference, which is bringing together already thousands of people. You know, that's a very big achievement for us as a technology ecosystem.
The fact that I am being interviewed today about Silicon Mountain makes me proud already. That is something very important. That means we have been able to attract some attention towards us due to the various things we have been doing. For example, at the level of community, I would like to appreciate what the Google Developers Group local community here have done. They have made it such a way that Google has had an eye on Silicon Mountain. Other big organizations have had an eye on Silicon Mountain. So I'm really proud, first of all, that attention we have gotten is a priority, and what we are building, because as I said, we mostly, it's a young community, and what this young community is doing already and getting attention is something that really, really, really I appreciate. Yeah, so there's a lot of effort, and a lot of youths are trying to break the hardness of the difficult situations that tech is facing in general in Cameroon.
In Africa, figures suggest that only about 10% of graduates get to be employed in what they study, and the number of jobless young people has been on a steady increase over the past years. With these hundreds of youths clicking and buzzing in Africa and beyond, there is need to wonder if the tech way is not the way forward to a sustainable fight against unemployment and its associated ills.
We come together in a forum called Silicon Mountain where we discuss about the possibility of us using technology for the betterment of our society, for the betterment of our countrymen, and for the betterment of our communities.
I wish that the importance of technology would be emphasized in our community. In the sense that for the most part, even some youths who try to engage in it right now, they are worried about what exactly are they getting themselves into. Of course, technology has its own side of the story where the youths could tend to. But if there is a conscious education on what technology is and its uses, then youths can really make use of it.
We currently are looking at building an innovation city, okay, like what we have in Silicon Valley. Silicon Valley is actually a place, it's a location where you have all of these startups with all of the resources. Our dream in Silicon Mountain is to have Boya or some parts of Boya become that kind of a place where these innovation entrepreneurs can actually set up their companies and begin to do real business. You know, as at now, the innovation community is not too well developed, you know, so we are looking at getting to that level.
I'm looking more at us focusing on the synergy of understanding our strengths, celebrating who we are as individuals, not trying to be another person. I would not like to see us competing with one another, but I'd rather like to see us celebrating one another's gifts and then being able to fortify what we have as individuals and complement one another. I believe that we are stronger like that.
I wish that one day the name Silicon Valley will be forgotten and the name Silicon Mountain will take the place. The guys are very hardworking guys, very honest guys, and I can say that just looking at how it is structured, you will know that we have a lot of trust for each other. So I pray and I know that if we keep doing what we're doing and working hard, and with the support of the government, mostly in the term of policy making, Silicon Mountain can beat Silicon Valley.
One thing I would like Silicon Mountain to achieve is, like, When I take a taxi from maybe Malingo Junction, I have to see maybe former Las Vegas, right? But I would like, if you have to take a taxi from Malingo Junction, I say Jungle Hub, for example. Taxi already knows where to leave me, that is a tech. So I want tech to actually get to the heart of the people. Yes, so get to the mind of the people, such that university graduate history, people doing history, doing geography know about it. Because in our collaboration, we have mostly been collaborating within ourselves, like tech guys. But we want, I'm hoping for a future whereby West Boya is a place where the lawyer is thinking tech, the economist is thinking tech, somebody doing, for example, English or translator is thinking tech. So everybody is having tech ideas and thinking how they can propose solutions or change our local environment using technology. So I'm actually looking at some sort of Silicon Valley.
These are definitely innovations to keep eyes on.